Hello friends, this is Ajit Kumar Jain from Technocrates, the IT group of institutions Bhopal, an assistant professor in Department of Civil Engineering, presenting an expert lecture on watershed management. We need clean water for our health, recreation and industry. We all want it and we all affect its quality. To maintain adequate water quality, we must look at all activities that take place in an area and make sure that their environmental impacts on nearby waterways are minimal. Watershed management is simply a systems approach to environment protection. We will discuss the importance of watersheds as a part of a healthy environment and economy. A watershed is an area of land that drains into a lake or river. As rainwater runs downhill, they carry sediment and other materials into our streams, lakes, wetlands, and groundwater. A watershed is the area of land that catches all precipitation, such as rain or snow, and drains or seeps into a marsh, stream, river, lake, or groundwater. Understanding watershed is the first step in protecting the water and other natural resources. Healthy watersheds are vital for a healthy environment and economy because surfaced groundwater is part of the total water cycle. The activities of people who live within a watershed affect the health of the waters that drain into it. Any activity that changes soil permeability, vegetation type or cover, water quality, quantity or rate of flow at a location can change the characteristics of a stream. For years, we understood that direct pollution of waters must be controlled or prevented. We were aware that obvious sources such as factory waste or untreated waste water from a failing septic system were harmful to the local waters. Now, we know that even the silt that results from the smallest disturbance of the topsoil or the bacteria-laden runoff from livestock pastures also impacts water quality. Using the watershed approach, we can take a broader view of the environment, where our activities are interconnected across local and regional boundaries. Homes, farms, forests, small towns and big cities all exist in watersheds. Watersheds come in all shapes and sizes. Some watershed boundaries cross state and even international borders. Some watersheds include millions of square miles, others are just a few acres. Just as creeks drain into rivers, watersheds are nearly always part of a larger watershed. Using the watershed approach, we can take a broader view of the environment, where our activities are interconnected across local and regional boundaries. Now, delineation of watershed. Hydrologically, watershed is an area from which the runoff flows to a common point on the drainage system. Every stream, tributary, or river has an associated watershed, and small watersheds aggregate together to become larger watersheds. Water travels from headwater to the downward location and meets with similar strength of stream. Then it forms one order higher stream. The stream order is a measure of the degree of stream branching within a watershed. Each length of stream is indicated by its order. For example, first order, second order, third order, etc. The start or headwaters of a stream with no other streams flowing into it is called the first order stream. First order streams flow together to form a second order stream. Second order streams flow into a third order stream and so on. Stream order describes the relative location of the reach in the watershed. Identifying stream order is useful to understand amount of water availability in reach and its quality, and also used as criteria to divide larger watershed into smaller unit. Moreover, criteria for selecting watershed size also depend on the objectives of the development and terrain slope. Now, source of pollution. The majority of water quality problems can be traced to obvious causes called point source pollution. This means the problem is traced to a specific location such as a pipe or disposal site. When detected, these problem sources are controlled. However, water quality is also affected by diffuse input originating from large land areas or many small scattered sources called non-point source pollution. Many non-point source pollutants, agricultural fertilizers and storm water runoff, for example, are strongly related to land uses. The watershed management approach integrates the traditional regulatory programs addressing point source pollutants and non-regulatory programs, those addressing non-point source pollution. To clean up a particular contaminant, first we must recognize that it may come from multiple sources. Then we must identify which sources are significant contributors and prioritize our efforts accordingly. For example, excess nitrate can originate from septic systems, sewage treatment plants, livestock manure, agricultural fertilizers or urban landscape maintenance, but land use patterns will dictate the proportion contributed by any of these sources within a particular area. Now, objectives of watershed management. The overall objective of watershed management is to maintain the social, economic and ecological watershed functions in a balanced manner and thereby to contribute to the sustainable development and the reduction of negative external impacts in a region. The goal provides the framework for the following major objectives of watershed management. To ensure that beneficial uses of water resources and other related resources are sustained. To achieve specified and agreed management targets for water and related resources. To ensure the avoidance of negative off-site impacts on water and related resources. To ensure that negative impacts of human activities on watershed functions are recognized and avoided as much as possible. To appropriately manage other resources that impact on water, such as land. To promote social and economic development. To conserve, minimize the degradation of or rehabilitate resources and the environment. To decrease local vulnerability to climatic extremes. To ensure maintenance of biodiversity. Objectives for watershed management depend on country-specific conditions and often on the priorities of higher-ranking development policies and socio-economic development plans. Now, principles and conceptual elements of watershed management. The current understanding of watershed management, which is based on the lessons from the past, implies that effective watershed management needs to be holistic and interdisciplinary. It has to consider natural as well as human resources, coordinate development needs and potentials and include mechanisms of conflict resolution. Modern watershed management has the following principles and conceptual elements: holistic and flexible. Neither the natural watershed ecosystem nor the human social and economic systems that exist and operate within it are static. Both are complex and dynamic systems comprising various elements which interact and influence each other. Therefore, it is necessary for watershed management to address identified problems in a holistic way and remain flexible to be able to respond to changes over time. People-centered and participatory. The degree to which people and civil society actively participate in conservation and resource management is one of the most critical factors that determines the success or failure of the process. Participation enables stakeholders to formulate their interests and concerns and integrate them into decision making, planning and policy development. Participation can take on a more passive form with a relatively low level of involvement as in the top-down consultative model. Alternatively, the bottom-up approach promotes much higher levels of public and institutional involvement and can lead towards civil empowerment and self-mobilization. Negotiation and dialogue processes. Watershed management facilitates the multi-sectoral and multi-stakeholder negotiation processes by providing the necessary platform to examine the interests of the different parties from the overall watershed perspective. This results in the formulation of guidelines or plans for the maintenance of watershed functions. It is important that dialogue and negotiation take place at all levels between government, non-governmental organizations, the private sector, community organizations, and throughout civil society. Government here includes the national, provincial, district, and community levels. Dialogue and negotiation should aim to cover policy formulation, institutional support, planning, implementation, monitoring, and capacity building. The general aim is to ensure that the negative impacts of individual activities on the watershed functions are recognized and as much as possible avoided, and that beneficial policies and practices are identified and promoted. Integration, multidisciplinary and multi-sectoral. Watershed management is not a sector itself and could instead be perceived as a dialogue process which draws in all of the relevant sectors: water resources, agriculture, forestry, environment, transport, energy, interior, land management, rural development, and pursues effective collaboration and coordination. The requirement is for vertical consistency to be achieved between the various watershed institutions in the hierarchy of drainage units. Institutional consistency to be achieved between the watershed institutions and the territorial administrative hierarchy, and horizontal consistency to be achieved between the line agencies involved. Through the involvement of all sectors, watershed management should be based on data, scientific knowledge, and factual information provided by the physical, natural, and socio-economic sciences, as well as the traditional knowledge of resource users. In this context, it is important and necessary to identify an appropriate and context-specific balance between a fully integrated approach and a sectoral approach which takes into account that both extremes include certain risks. The concept of watershed management. Watershed management is the people-oriented supporting process designed to reach the objectives of watershed management. We will use the following working definition for this process. Watershed management is the process of people guiding and organizing water, land, and forest resource use on a watershed in order to provide desired goods and services without adversely affecting water, soil, and vegetation resources. Embedded in this concept is the recognition of the ecological interrelationships among land use, soil, and water, as well as the ecological, social, and economic linkages between upland and downstream areas. Watershed management balances the three dimensions of sustainable development, ecological, economic, and social in the watershed context. Components of watershed management. Entry point activity. Entry point activity is the first formal project intervention which is undertaken after the transect walk, selection, and finalization of the watershed. It is highly recommended to use knowledge-based entry point activity to build the rapport with the community. Direct cash-based entry point activity must be avoided, as such activities give a wrong signal to the community at the beginning for various interventions. Details of the knowledge-based entry point activity to build rapport with the community, ensuring tangible economic benefits to the community members, are described here. Land and water conservation practices. Soil and water conservation practices are the primary step of watershed management program. Conservation practices can be divided into two main categories. Number one, in situ, and number two, ex situ management. Land and water conservation practices, those made within agricultural fields like construction of contour bunds, graded bunds, field bunds, terraces building, broad bed and furrow practice, and other soil moisture conservation practices are known as in situ management. These practices protect land degradation, improve soil health, and increase soil moisture availability and groundwater recharge. Moreover, construction of check dam, farm pond, gully control structures, pits excavation across the stream channel is known as ex situ management. Ex situ watershed management practices reduce peak discharge in order to reclaim gully formation and harvest substantial amount of runoff, which increases groundwater recharge and irrigation potential in watershed. Nutrient management. Water only cannot increase crop productivity to its potential level without other interventions. A balanced nutrient diet along with adequate moisture availability and pest and disease-free environment can turn agricultural production several folds higher compared to unmanaged land. Integrated nutrient management involves the integral use of organic manure, crop straw, and other plant and tree biomass material, along with little application of chemical fertilizer. both macro and micronutrients. Integrated pest management involves use of different crop pest control practices like cultural, biological and chemical methods in a combined and compatible way to suppress pest infestations. Thus, the main goals of integrated nutrient management and integrated pest management are to maintain soil fertility, manage pest and the environment so as to balance cost, benefits, public health and environmental quality. Crop diversification and intensification. The crop diversification refers to bringing about a desirable change in the existing cropping patterns towards a more balanced cropping system to reduce the risk of crop failure. And crop intensification is the increasing cropping intensity and production to meet the ever-increasing demand for food in a given landscape. Watershed management puts emphasis on crop diversification and intensification through the use of advanced technologies, especially good variety of seeds, balanced fertilizer application, and by providing supplemental irrigation. Use of multiple resources. Farmers, those solely dependent on agriculture, hold high uncertainty and risk of failure due to various extreme events, pest and disease attack, and market shocks. Therefore, integration of agriculture and non-agriculture activities is required at various scales for generating consistent resource of income and support for their livelihood. For example, agriculture, livestock production, and dairy farming together can make more resilient and sustainable system compared to adopting agriculture practice alone. Product or byproduct of one system could be utilized for other and vice versa. In this example, biomass production after crop harvesting could be utilized for livestock feeding and manure obtained from livestock could be applied in field to maintain soil fertility. It includes horticulture plantation, aquaculture and animal husbandry at individual farm, household or community scale. Capacity building. Watershed development requires multiple interventions that jointly enhance the resource base and livelihoods of the rural people. This requires capacity building of all the stakeholders from farmer to policy makers. Capacity building is a process to strengthen the abilities of people to make effective and efficient use of resources in order to achieve their own goals on a sustained basis. Unawareness and ignorance of the stakeholders about the objectives, approaches, and activities are the reasons that affect the performance of the watersheds. Capacity building program focuses on construction of low-cost soil and water conservation methods, production and use of biofertilizers and biopesticides, income-generating activities, livestock-based activities, waste land development, market linkage for primary stakeholders. Clear understanding of strategic planning, monitoring and evaluation mechanism and other expertise in field of science and management is essential for government officials and policy makers. The stakeholders should be aware about the importance of various activities. Their benefits in terms of economics, social and environmental factors. Therefore, organizing various training at different scales are important for watershed development. Thank you.